rule in the book, and this is why they complain.
So please, everyone, just one word. This will be the lightning talk session. If any of you wants to join and talk about his or her project for a couple of minutes, that's the last call, because we will be starting very shortly with the first presentation about Athena project right now. Mm-hmm. We have currently five lightning talks. So if you want to join, please keep your talk shorter than, let's say, 8 to 10 minutes maximum. So reach me if you have something for us, and else enjoy the lightning talks in a few minutes.
Mm-hmm. And do you have a remote for that, or?
I have this and the remote there.
And the what?
The remote.
Ah, I don't have. Wait. Sure don't. There.
The first one is the pointer, and reviews the next.
Uh-huh. Okay, hello. So I come from a new project. We call the Athena project Athena. We have a bit of confusion with Intel, but we're not from Intel, just to clarify. We've had a couple complaints about that. Doesn't work. So, what is it? So it's a virtual world similar to Second Life or VR chat. It was created by the company High Fidelity, was started by Philip Rosedale, who created Second Life originally. And after he left Second Life, he went on to create a new world, which he called High Fidelity. And kind of the idea of that is that what's high fidelity representation of reality, kind of. Sorry, understand it. It's not about audio. So the commercial project is almost entirely open source, in that there are just a couple bits missing. There's an audio codec, which we've already replaced. And there are central services which manage user accounts, but are pretty trivial and actually optional. So that's not that big a deal. It died, unfortunately, a couple of weeks ago, mostly because of management reasons. I think the technology is actually quite promising, but, well, they didn't really have much of a business model and had trouble finding users. In some ways, the very attractive to me nature of the project works against business interests because it's extremely distributed, extremely open, and so you can't really make anybody pay any money for it. I'm not quite sure how he convinced people to give him money for that, but we're very lucky, so we're not going to say no to it. Once it died, we've picked it up, we've mirrored all the documentation, all the content that there was, and we are continuing development. So, what is it? It's a fully distributed, scalable virtual world. What do I mean by that? You can run your own server anywhere, like Linode or any other provider. Each server itself is composed of different pieces, like, for instance, the audio mixer, which it's an environment with an audio chat. So you can actually run the audio on its own server, if you want, to distribute it all. And even the physics is distributed in that actually the server hands out pieces of the world to simulate to clients. It's a quite interesting idea that I'm not sure is entirely stable, but, well, it's there. It supports Oculus Rift and HTC Vive. There is experimental support for the Quest and for Android, but it's not entirely stable yet. It still needs work. It runs on Windows, Linux, and OS X, of course. And it's written in modern C++ and scriptable in JavaScript, so it's actually quite convenient. If anybody here worked with Second Life, for instance, it's much, much better in that regard. Second Life is a huge pain to develop for. All right. So since this is a gaming we have a gaming subject here, what's the gaming potential? Well, it's a 3D engine with VR, scripting, voice chat, and networking. You can set up your own infrastructure. It's not a centralized thing, so you can just host it yourself and do whatever you want. Everything can be scripted, including the UI. And, well, it's not in itself a gaming engine. It's more a social world in which you can make games. So think, for instance, creating games in Second Life or in Minecraft. The idea is that you have an existing world in which you already have users, and you are just kind of adding games on top of that because, well, you already have your virtual neighbors or whatever, and you want to play chess with them, or you could make certainly something more complicated. Right, so I'm going to show you a couple very short videos about what it looks like. Have in mind, most of us are developers, we aren't graphics artists, so actually it's the project has had some trouble attracting artists due to its very open nature, in that in Second Life artists can control very well their creations, their distribution, and their usage. Here it doesn't work like that. Philip Rosedale wanted to create the kind of web browser of VR, in that it's pretty much like trying to protect images on a web page. You can just copy it. Assets are loaded over HTTP. So, right. So here's a VR point of view. We have this tablet kind of thing, with which you can manage the entire interface. It needs some work. But it does everything. I mean, you can get into, you can use the entire functionality from there, get into the debug menus. So it's quite complete in that regard. All right, one piece of functionality that I quite like is that there is the concept of zones. What are those? You can define parts of the world in which the environment changes. So, for instance, one thing that I found very lacking in Second Life in that you can't create a dark basement in there because, well, the world has a global lighting, and that's always the same. Under the high-fidelity technology, you can just define a chunk of the world which changes how the environment is lit. It's going to loop again, and you should see again. See? Here it changes. This is a kind of development kind of environment. It's not very pretty. And we have a bunch of other random things, like, for instance, of course, we can have non-human avatars. We can have flexible geometry, which you can actually touch and interact with. And you can animate your avatars in that you build a skeleton in Blender. One member of our community actually created a great plugin for rigging avatars and converting content to be compatible with our world. It's very convenient in that way. All right. So we have a small team and quite a few contributors already. It just started a couple months ago, more or less. Because, well, we've been always slowed down by the main company in that it wasn't very good to work with as an open source project. It was hard to make contributions. We moved much faster. So actually, when it died, we actually started getting more stuff done. Several of the ex-employees of the company actually work with us. All right. And I just wanted to add that it's actually been used commercially. There's actually a children's TV show, I think, in Italy that actually uses this technology. They actually use render part of it in VR. If anybody is interested, I can show you later. Right. So why are we here? Well, we're mostly getting started still, in that the project died quite recently. The shutdown was announced a bit more than a month ago. So we've been working very hard on getting a release process, replacing closed parts with open source code, and just getting a better feel for the code base and working as a good team. So we still need more people. And specifically, we don't have currently an OSX developer, which will be very good. Android is also kind of post right now, but it works. We have C++ developers, but always could use more, certainly. It's a very large project. And, of course, 3D artists, since it's a 3D world, and, it's not going to show anything if we don't have any content. Right. So here's our website. We mainly communicate while Discord. If you're interested in this at all, you should definitely join it because, this is a very kind of early part of talk on our part. We're still getting used to this, so the main code base has been around for a long time, so it's not like completely broken or anything, but still you might run into some sort of minor trouble, so definitely come to us and ask about it. We have in-world meetings if you actually install the client. We're going to have a bunch of meetings soon. We have a bunch of developer community meetings. This is a kind of a philosophical sort of discussion. We actually have a professional that set up shop in our little world and talks about philosophical topics. And we even have a bar trivia competition if you want just some kind of random fun and socialize with the people that are there. And that's that. Thank you.
If you have any questions, please meet outside of the room so everyone can have time.
By the way, if anybody wants a bookmark, a physical one, I have cards.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Ah, sure. Just give it back later. Oh, sure. Yeah. Give me a second.
In your belt or your computer. This is a quicker one.
I don't have presentations. Yes. Okay. Okay. Hello, I'm Jan Chazul from Costa Rica. I'm coming from a from an open source organization called Spacebeam. We are organizing a side event for FOSDEM, which is a StarCraft Brood War AI tournament, bots for bots. We, in our group, we see StarCraft as a good testbed for artificial intelligence research, because the uncertainty that the game have in chess or Go, both players have access to the board, both can see where the action the other player is. StarCraft is completely different. We haven't seen in this scene, this is a scene with 10 years of continuous tournaments, with continuous work for companies that come and go. We can talk about, or we have bots made from Samsung, we have made bots made for Facebook, just for mention two of the biggest companies. But we have been seeing participation, maybe not in tournaments, but on the research aspect of other, colorful names from industry. Currently, the state of affairs in the aspect of competition was that only Windows bots can compete. That's kind of a shame. So we built this competition in order to enable support for everyone using Linux and everyone using another languages. Or the idea is be more inclusive about the tools that you can use to build the thing. We have support for a project called Torchcraft built by Facebook. With that, we have access to the PyTorch ecosystem. So we build this tournament. We have 12 bots registered, 11 submitted at the end. And this is the conference where I was, in theory, coming here to present the results. But for technical issues, the tournament haven't started yet. So I'm here to give you my face to the people that register and say I'm sorry, but we are actually going to have a tournament. It's running as soon as we fix the technical issues with our container system. We are developing everything from scratch because there are actually solutions for running bot versus bot competitions using Docker, but Docker don't have really good support for the GPU. So if you want to train machine learning models that have good access to the GPU, that don't require a daemon running with root in your system, we use Singularity, the container solution for our environment. And to be kind of specific, our tournament manager die when we start a 31 container because we have like an IP issue that we need to fix. But that's it that's my blocker on the technical side. But what we plan to do, my community, what we plan to organize is an event for FOSDEM and use hopefully this game development dead room every year or the FOSDEM event every year to let you know about our community, to invite you to participate, to invite you to of course not only build bots for Windows, to have the tool and the power that the Linux ecosystem with all these languages and the kernel that we all use and love for this kind of endeavors. That's where I'm coming from. We plan to make this an annual event. This is the first time that we are organizing it. We are having like a rough start, but we are compromised with this idea that use StarCraft Brood War as the sandbox that it is to test the development of new algorithms and new make progress on the field. So that's it from my side. I hope that this kind of thing interests you, and if you want to learn how to make bots and compete, or you want to learn a little bit more about the scene, actually we are like four bot developers right here in this room. So you, if you can have questions, you can ask me on the hallway. That's it. So thank you.
Just have a few.
Yeah, basically, just like when we try to do this,
Okay. This is not. This is just for recording, right?
Yeah, just for the screen.
Okay.
In this, in your pocket or your belt.
Any idea? Any idea why this might not be working? What is our problem? Okay, everything seems to be in order. Maybe try a USB or something?
We need to try the USB.
Sorry?
It's my laptop. I think it's an USB only, so yeah, I'm not sure if it's... Yeah, it's just a question.
Oh, thank you. Okay, can I start?
Yes.
Hello, everyone. Hello everyone, my talk is Introduction to StarCraft AI, and I just realized that we should have switched up the order of presentations with Jens just so. So I don't know how many of you are into StarCraft. As you can see by my shirt, I'm very much into it, and I'm not counting the answers, but it's not enough. So we have this thing called Student StarCraft AI Tournament. This is where it all began, and don't let the word student confuse you. This is a tournament which is a yearly bot versus bot tournament. That means that people code up their AIs that play Brood War, and these AIs have a tournament, and someone wins, mostly bragging rights. So this is the page, and bots are programmed in C++ or Java, using something called the Brood War API. The Brood War API kind of emulates the calls and the ways that humans interact with the game. And there are also always debates how much control we should give to bots, but pretty much a bot can do everything a human can do and not more. And obviously some things are working differently. We are directly issuing comments to the game engine, so it's basically a hack inside StarCraft. Not seeing the bots are not seeing the screen. I guess many of you have seen Alpha Star performing. That is completely different. This is Brood War. This is not SC2. That's not to say that SC2 AI is a bad thing or you shouldn't pursue it. I mean, they are people too, but this is better. So, and this predates Alpha Star. It's about 2010. When it first started, and there is a live stream also. sorry for the bad potato quality, but I didn't want to take up too much bandwidth for showing 10 seconds of game. So these are these gentle bots are AIs by Haupen, and actually ADS is the AI written by the Samsung team. which won some tournaments. I don't know exactly which ones, but yeah, it's a quite advanced one. And yeah, that's enough. You can watch it anytime because it's a 24/7 stream. And there is a YouTube channel as well. There is the weekly broadcast. Basically, now it's the tournament stage. There is a yearly tournament. There is an ongoing competition, and ladder. You can watch the reports casted by some very good casters and also me. So yeah, that's it. What I want to also show you, it's something called OpenBW, where some talented developers, or much like crazy fanatics, reverse engineered the whole StarCraft Brood War engine, and it is available to view on GitHub. Now, what I want to show you, it's basically one file. So it is quite hard to decipher it, and we don't really need to use it. The BW API or Brood War API is a self-contained package. But you can look inside the code of the OpenBW, and it's functionally identical to StarCraft itself. So much so that even the bugs and quirks are reproduced. So there is also, you think I'm joking, but it is necessary to emulate the level of play. So you can do like the extractor trick, if you know what that is, basically tricking the game into overusing your supply in the game. And who doesn't play StarCraft now, I have no idea what I'm talking about. So regarding competitions, there is the yearly student StarCraft AI tournament, and there is something called AIDE, and it is stands for Artificial Intelligence and Interactive Digital Entertainment. Yeah, this is an AI conference, very prestigious. Some smart people say smart things there, and sometimes we get in. And there is the student StarCraft AI, not student, but StarCraft AI competition, which is organized by the same crew. So if you write a bot, you can talk about it, and also you win some bragging rights within AI circles with this, I like to think. So that is the brief overview. There are some other competitions going on, mostly yearly or I think they are yearly. For example, the Conference of Games organized by, I don't know which university in South Korea, and there has been serious AI research going on in the area of StarCraft. Samsung and Facebook had some teams who competed and wrote about and quite graciously developed some frameworks that we can use. I'd like to comment Facebook on this. I know Facebook as a company, you might have opinions about them, but the tools that are provided by them freely and accessible for everyone are good in this particular scene. That's not a judgment of the company itself. Let's skip that. So about me, I skipped the introduction in the middle of the talk. My name is Shonko. My background is enterprise Java developer. I mostly worked with banking and loyalty systems, and no one fucking cares because this is not LinkedIn. And I have a site called Making Computer Do Things. The name is, someone asked to please describe in simple words what you do. So yeah, I make computer do things. And I view myself as an unsolicited community ambassador for this whole community. I basically make them talk when they don't want to. And there is some things I do in this site. And first of all, when I started out, I wrote a bot myself, and it's called Jumpy Dog Go Bot because of I have a way of naming things. And you see, this is a 30-part basically guide and developing some good code, and of course a lot of memes. So yes, yeah, basically, let me just grasp into it. And memes, bad code, and Java. What more you need? And this has 30 parts. There is the Undermind podcast. Play on the Overmind. Again, if you're not into StarCraft, you don't know what is that. That's my shirt as well. And interview both authors, developers, and anyone interesting in the scene, and some not interesting people, I'm sure. So recently I started to branch out into more StarCrafty things, presented this scene more to gamers as well, And the latest episode, I had an interview with Freakling, a famous StarCraft map designer. So everything that can be possibly related to the Brood War AI scene, but it is mostly about Brood War AI and talking with members of the community and, well, basically having fun. At least I do when I abuse them verbally. And that's it. Another project I do, it's called the StarCraft Human and AI League. And yeah, this website I threw together in 10 minutes, so I'm very sorry for that. And this is StarCraft Human and AI League. Basically, if you want to play against these bots, then you have to download something called Drop Launcher, which is kind of very much outdated. And you have to import some files, and it's not working, and you have to look it up in the internet. And this is the step when all the gamers just leave the room, and if you're not a developer, you don't have that kind of endurance to tinkering with things. So my project is it's schnell.com, schnell with a lisp, I guess, and it's a tool. It's a persistent online platform for you to play against Brood War AI. So you just load it up and click on a bot, a map, and your race, and there you go. There is an introductory video. I will not play it because we don't really have the time. Something that you should check out. Unfortunately, it's not public yet because don't have infinite time, and it is just entering the beta stage. I must commend that the community is helping me a lot with this, and I have a lot of help with hosting and solving technical problems. Also, a few words about the community. In the Student StarCraft AI Tournament page, there is a link for our Discord. Please join us. Please interact with us. You can bring your memes as well. And the community is usually people who played Brood War back in the day. So that means we are kind of older and thusly more experienced, more experienced in development, have more development experience. That's not a judgment in any way, shape, or form. It's just a statement. So basically, we can and we are coding and dissecting and can solve everything. You can interact with people generally in AI research circles as well. One of the guys I'd like to mention is David Churchill, an AI researcher in the University of Alberta, who is organizing the AID conference tournament as well. And yeah, if you want to learn coding, I guess most of you know something about coding by now. But if you want to learn coding, learn Brood War AI development, or sharpen your skills, it is a good place because we love to solve problems and we love to go into the nitty gritty details. Like I presented, there is a guy who decompiled the StarCraft engine. So that's the level of engagement you could expect from us. And I also have some online presence as well. This is my YouTube channel, also Making Computer Do Things. Everything is called that. I have YouTube, Twitch, and the site. And here there is a live AI coding stream. The point of this is we made an AI that can beat the stock AI sometimes, if the moon is right, in 3 hours. So it's not that hard. It's not that hard. You can get into it. Writing some basic bot is certainly achievable in a human time frame. But maybe if writing a good bot now, that takes a lot of time. Currently, the supported frameworks are C++, Java. Java meaning technically any GVM-based language can be used. And one of the top bots, Purple Wave, is written in Scala. And yeah, that's actually a guy named Dan Gant wrote it, who is a Facebook AI researcher. So I'm just name-dropping here to be more famous or something. So yeah, he's a good guy. So this is 3 hours and 19 minutes. That's about half hour of silliness, I think. So yeah, you can do that. And finally, regarding presenting this scene to gamers and talking about the Schnell project, I was recently on something called the Pylon Show. You might have heard about it if you're into StarCraft. This slide is like 90% bragging and 10% actual information, but go watch it. And there is also Nathan Roth, aka Antiga, who is a community organizer in this. And I think this is all the surface level stuff I wanted to say about this. Yet again, it would have benefited us to switch the order of this and this presentation and TorchUp. TorchUp is another language we kind of support is Python, and we want to extend to a lot of languages if that is possible. The BW API team is working on that, and eventually it will get done. Oh, well, thank you very much. That's all from me.
Is on your pocket or your belt?
I think you're ready to go. Be sharing your screen.
I will admit, because I don't get you on butter.
What? One?
Just, I want to look at the...
It's the best way.
Yeah, the bubble won't work it out. Okay.
manager is mainly made of QuickTime movies, which you can play. So I guess a lot of you did that or used to do that. So you watch the movies and you see, oh, I can press this button. And what happened was I wanted to read. And then I could scroll, I had to turn it back on again to 100% actually play the game again. Which worked, I already knew how to finish the adventure game, and that's when I started looking at, I know what's comfy and I used it, I was like, well, it's a game, let's see, I have working support. And that's what I did. Scumfy, or Save Record, is written in Director, it's a product sister of Macromedia Flash, which is related to it, a different technology. And what happened, ScumVM already had an engine implementation, which was dormant for 2 years. And I was like, yeah, let's try to see if I can do that. I mean, I know programming, but, well, how much do you have written one language and or not in C++ or C? Everybody, cool. I mean, I know how to look for things in strings. I know how to, that it was fun to start going in and learning like lots of different things. Shortly back to ScumVM. I guess who hasn't heard of ScumVM? Oh, who hasn't? Yes, who hasn't? What it does is re-implements old game engines. And for example, Monkey Island is written in Scum, the language they use. And ScumVM has re-implemented that. And what after a while, more engines. Here's a list of all the lost companies. Is it legible from the back?
No, it's not.
Better? Yeah. Well, it's a huge list of all games that is playable with Director. And so what we're doing with ScumVM now is we're targeting the whole engine and re-implementing parts. What is that? I'm pretty new to actually doing game development stuff. And what I'm working on is having these small functions that are in there that needs to be implemented. Like you can beep, and there's a command for beep, so that's pretty easy to start with working. Like beep, it was. Well, now beep is working. And one of the things I wanted to tell you is it can be daunting to start working with it.
Two other people started working on it again, and they're hitting it off. I'm seeing their commit messages, and it's like a huge thing, and they're writing the Lexer, which is almost complete. And
all kinds of stuff. And here I am just working on small parts. And do you want to start working on it? Or do you want me to show some code, or do you want me to show some working director in like how it works back in the day? Some examples. Code. Okay. I'll use code.
here was one of my first commits. It's the, can I walk again? Or I'll stand here. I was really powdery. It's or after the image is shown, or something happens, and that, thank you. And that's when it's using Lingo. And one of the things was we get an argument, but here was this, or if there was an argument, and it Lingo was an easy language to use to read, so. You could say beep and it would beep, but you also could say, well, beep one or beep 100. And so even a simple beep function has like a little bit of logic to check, okay, is there a function or not, or is there a parameter? And yeah, it's cool to work on small things and actually see the progress and I hope that someday in like, well, I don't know the time frame, but we'll get to replay my my safecracker game with everything implemented. Yes, that was it. I mean, I would love for more people to join. I mean, it can be humbling. It's hard to start something afresh and in a project where everybody is already more developed, knows everything, and you're starting anew. But yeah, if you want to work on a game engine with we end up playable games. Go check Scum out and see if you can work with us. All right.